On New Year's Day 1982, more than 19,000 fans packed the historic CheckerDome for an exciting night of professional wrestling. The event was a tribute to one of St. Louis's most beloved sports figures, Sam Muchnick. We've turned back the clock and scoured our exclusive archives to bring you this special presentation on the man behind the matches who made the Gateway City the capital of the wrestling world. Hello to you. I'm Mike Colombo, and welcome to your ringside look at the Sam Muchnick retirement card of 1982. Muchnick planted St. Louis's wrestling roots with the creation of Wrestling at the Chase. And whether you're an old-school wrestling lifer or a modern-day fan, what you'll witness over the next half hour is a piece of wrestling history made right here in St. Louis. But first, a look at the cultural fabric of professional wrestling in St. Louis and the visionary behind it. Long before Don King, Vince McMahon, or Dana White, there was one promoter's name at the top of the fight game. That man was St. Louis's own Sam Muchnick.
Sam was, he was just a thorough professional, which is the highest accolade I can think.
Sam was one of the few promoters that was respected by everybody across the board.
Muchnick's promotional prowess started in the 1940s. He was one of the founding fathers of the National Wrestling Alliance, pro wrestling's dominant governing body at the time. In 1950, he became the NWA's president. But his greatest work began in 1959 when he founded the St. Louis Wrestling Club.
Wrestling at the Chase.
Muchnick and the club became the driving force behind the now iconic Wrestling at the Chase television series.
Joe Garagiola.
Hi, everybody, and welcome once again to Wrestling at the Chase. Yes, sir, wall to wall, and boy, tonight we're going to have them all over this place.
Von Erich and Valentine up against the canvas wall. It's a Donnybrook.
Sam Muchnick is the most fair promoter I guess I've ever met in my life. The greatest promoter that in the United States, no doubt about that.
Here comes Kerry Von Erich. Von Erich pushes Race into the ring.
St. Louis was like the wrestling capital of the United States for certain, and the world, because there was not a city anywhere in the world that had access to that kind of talent. Every time it ran.
Sam, being a very honorable gentleman he is.
Sam was Mr. Wrestling in his time.
Muchnick said, okay.
He made the sport. And I don't think there's too many people that would say elsewhere.
Such a first-class person, you know, just always so kind, so mannerly, and really loved this business so much, and what a great promoter that Sam was.
Under Muchnick's direction, Wrestling at the Chase aired on KPLR-11 for more than 24 years, featuring some 1,100 episodes.
Hey, look out!
He helped create some of the biggest names in wrestling history.
Oh, what a suplex! What a suplex by Cowboy Bob Orton!
This was built because of Sam Muchnick.
One thing my father was the honest wrestling promoter. He was essentially a man of honor and a den of thieves.
You worked for Sam, you worked for one hell of a guy. He had the respect of those wrestlers, I'll tell you that. They all worked for him. Sam was great, a wonderful man.
Prior to the action on that January night, local, state, and national dignitaries poured into the CheckerDome to honor Muchnick's many contributions to the sport.
Everybody in this building knows that tonight is a very special night for wrestling in St. Louis and around the world. It's all because of one man. We all know that in our hearts. That's Sam Muchnick.
With famed wrestling announcer and friend Larry Matisick on the microphone, the Sam Muchnick farewell program started with a proper introduction of the legend everyone was there to honor.
Coming down that aisle, it will be the man we all want to thank tonight. The one and only promoter, Sam Muchnick.
Once inside the ring, what followed was a parade of friends, colleagues, and dignitaries ready to pay their respects.
In behalf of the city of St. Louis and Mayor Vincent C. Shamel Jr., we want to give you this proclamation. And today was Sam Muchnick's day. Today was Sam Muchnick's day.
On behalf of the governor of the state of Missouri and of the Senate of the state of Missouri, a proclamation and appreciation for all you've done for the people of the city of St. Louis and the state of Missouri.
The National Wrestling Alliance in gratitude for his four decades of dedication to the growth and perpetuation of pro wrestling, proclaimed Sam Muchnick World Champion Promoter. He blended the past to the present with dignity. He earned the respect among his peers with honesty. He created friendships forever with loyalty. Congratulations, Sam Muchnick.
After all the plaques and proclamations were collected, Muchnick took the microphone.
It's wonderful to be able to go out when you say you had a sellout. St. Louis has been good to me, and the only reason I was successful is because of the millions of fans in St. Louis and around the world that came to the matches. I've been successful because I had the finest wrestlers that anybody could procure for this area, for St. Louis, and I owe it all to you. A promoter cannot do well unless he gets the people in the building or if he gets the wrestlers. Thank you, St. Louis.
Ladies and gentlemen, Sam Muchnick.
The night's main event featured the Nature Boy, Ric Flair, defending his title against the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. That match is ahead, but when we return, we'll highlight the other matches on the card, featuring Wrestling at the Chase favorites and some of the best to ever step into the ring. Welcome back. The Sam Muchnick retirement card of 1982 was a who's who of pro wrestling. Nearly everyone competing had regional, national, and world championship title reigns on their respective resumes. In the opener, burly Bulldog Bob Brown, a longtime St. Louis favorite, faced off against California's diabolical Jerry Brown.
Bulldog Bob Brown was that everyman. That's what made him so popular here in St. Louis. He was the guy that you'd see getting off a truck and delivering mail. He was the butcher. He was, we'll go the baker, but nobody makes candles anymore.
The wild action spilled out of the ring, and at the 14-minute mark, the match concluded with a double countout. The NWA World Women's Tag Team title was featured next as the current champions, Joyce Grable and Wendy Richter, defended the straps against challengers Early Dawn and Sandy Partlow in a 2-out-of-3 falls matchup.
Wendy Richter became such a humongous star all over the world because of her beginning times with Cyndi Lauper and Hulk Hogan. And Joyce Grable was just starting out pretty much. Gorgeous young lady, we lost her recently and I miss her dearly.
After the first two decisions had the match at a 1-1 stalemate, the champions retained the title after Richter pinned Dawn 14 minutes in. Richter and Grable would go on to hold the title for 3 separate reigns. Match 3 had imposing bad guy Bob Sweetan tussle New Zealander Pat O'Connor, who held the NWA World's Heavyweight Championship from 1959 to 1961. At the time, the popular Kiwi was 57 years young.
Pat O'Connor was such a fixture here in St. Louis. He was one of the great National Wrestling Alliance champions, World Heavyweight Champions.
In 6 minutes, O'Connor got the win with a sleeper hold that brought the fans to a frenzy. A special 2-on-1 handicap attraction was featured next, where 474-pound crusher Jerry Blackwell tangled with a pair of Missouri natives with respective global careers, Kansas City's Bruce Reed and Sedalia's Ox Baker.
Jerry Blackwell was a big man, Crusher Blackwell, who could do everything. He is what Bronson Reed is today. The beginnings were Crusher Blackwell.
Following a mighty power slam, Blackwell claimed the Duke with a pin on Baker at 5 minutes and 48 seconds. The fifth match saw 8-time NWA World's Heavyweight Champion Harley Race and Greg Valentine facing David Von Erich and Rufus R. Jones in a tag team attraction. Seeing the Race-Valentine tandem was a rare treat, as both were more well known for their respective solo careers.
Harley rarely went into tag matches, but I remember talking to him a little bit before that match and asking him just that. And in his inimitable way, he'd say, I can also be the greatest tag team wrestler on God's green earth. And Greg Valentine, with that elbow that he got from his dad, the Atomic Skull Crusher, one of the deadliest competitors in all of pro wrestling.
As projected, the action was brutal, and the battle ended in a double disqualification just shy of 11 minutes. Anticipation was high as NWA Missouri heavyweight champion Ken Patera defended his title against Wrestling at the Chase favorite Dick the Bruiser.
The Missouri State champion, Ken Patera.
At the time, Patera was in his second reign as the Show Me State Kingpin.
I'm the owner of this. I possess this Missouri State title. You won it.
We have a Donnybrook, the Bruiser all over Patera.
But that would not intimidate the unflappable Bruiser.
Up, over the top, Dick the Bruiser.
He was that tough guy everybody liked. He was what Stone Cold Steve Austin eventually became. He was that guy that would take no guff from everybody, and he would just say what was on his mind. And when he got into the ring, whatever he said on those interviews, he did it in the ring. He always was truthful.
At 11 minutes and 48 seconds, the Bruiser claimed his third NWA Missouri Championship via pinfall. It would be his final run with the belt, which lasted 8 months.
And a lot of fans were very surprised at the result of that, but as they say in professional wrestling, anything can happen at any time.
To conclude the night, which followed the NWA World's Heavyweight Title main event, Canadian powerhouse Dewey Robertson squared off against the hated Baron Von Raschke.
Oh, the Baron with his claw. And Dewey Robertson, what a hero, who eventually became the missing link. Who knew that he would become as maniacal as the Baron?
It wasn't the Baron's night. After 3 minutes, Robertson quickly dispatched Raschke to send the 19,000-plus fans home on a high note and to put the final exclamation point on Muchnick's career. When we come back, it's the main event, the Nature Boy versus the American Dream for the NWA World's Heavyweight title. Welcome back to our exclusive look at the Sam Muchnick retirement card of 1982. The sold-out main event pitted the Nature Boy, Ric Flair, and the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. Longtime adversaries, it was only appropriate their rivalry continue with the NWA World's Heavyweight Championship on the line. Professional wrestlers competing in an arena full of frenzied fans experience a multitude of emotions. Even more so if they're one of the sport's biggest stars.
You walk down any aisle in the world and you're called the very best in the world. It's, I don't know how to really explain it. The hair stands up and the adrenaline starts running. That thousands of people right there at that particular moment are recognizing you as the man and what you're doing.
The world heavyweight champion, Nature Boy Ric Flair.
Ric Flair thrived off the boost of crowd confidence unlike any other. One of his signature lines, to be the man, you've got to beat the man.
Nature Boy Ric Flair.
At the time, Flair was 4 months deep into his inaugural reign as NWA World's Heavyweight Champion, claiming the belt over Rhodes at a Kansas City house show in September 1981. He felt the heat every time he appeared locally on KPLR-TV's Wrestling at the Chase.
I got the belt back! What about my rope? What about my pride? I'm a man!
Heading into the title tilt against his arch-rival, the Nature Boy confidently carried gold around his waist and matched it with a silver tongue.
And look what I travel with, the most beautiful women on the face of this earth. This is why the world's heavyweight champion, not Joe Montana, not Burt Reynolds, not turkeys like that, but a real man. The world's heavyweight champion.
Meanwhile, Rhodes had already held the NWA title twice before and came into the marquee match with plenty of momentum.
You want a battle? Rhodes does it, and he does it with flair, I should say.
Could the newly christened champ retain the strap against a fan favorite that sought his own third title? There was added intrigue that January night. Big Thunder Gene Kaniski, an in-ring enforcer and three-time NWA title holder himself, served as the match's special referee.
There was a lot of drama because Gene Kaniski, such a classic wrestler, Ric Flair looking and so hungry to win, and the same thing with the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. It was the roots of their feud right here in St. Louis, Missouri.
And their scrap inside the squared circle reached a fever pitch during the opening fall. A sunset flip aided by a hook of the tights netted Flair the first fall at 15 minutes and 31 seconds.
Ric Flair, he is one that I consider both a rough guy and a scientific wrestler. He could do it all. He wouldn't just go up there and go toe-to-toe. He would do that for a while, and all of a sudden he'd try to put him in a small package or something else.
Behind the eight ball after the opening setback, Rhodes knew that he needed to be flawless in the second fall if he wanted to keep his title dreams intact. An electric crowd fueled a potential comeback. Following his signature elbow drop, the American Dream evened the score at one fall apiece at the 21-minute mark.
You know, I always love two out of three fall matches. They don't have those a lot today. They almost don't have them anywhere. And the fans that love old school pro wrestling, two out of three falls is so exciting. When one guy wins one fall, another guy wins the other fall, who's gonna take it?
Deadlock, the two legends headed into the final frame holding nothing back. Near the end, Flair took advantage of Rhodes' weakened leg, and at 32 minutes, 18 seconds, he retained the gold by claiming the final pin, winning two falls to one. For those in attendance that night, it wasn't the most popular of outcomes, but the roller coaster match had fans feeling like they got their money's worth.
Sam wanted wrestling. That's what was written on his marquee. Sam held the National Wrestling Alliance together, that's for sure. For 26, 27 years.
And still, world heavyweight champion, Ric Flair!
Ric Flair would become the most decorated champion in NWA history, winning the heavyweight title belt 9 times. And he remains a wrestling icon to this day. When we return, Sam Muchnick's final curtain call. A memorable night full of stars wrangling in the ring culminated with a final tribute to the man they'd gathered to honor. Let's head back to the CheckerDome one final time to witness the post-show surprise party for Sam Muchnick.
I want to remind all you people that Muhammad Ali retired 4 times and came back. So I don't know. We had a big sellout tonight.
36 years of promotional excellence.
Success was Sam Muchnick's signature, and his swan song at the CheckerDome left its mark on the wrestling world. When the card concluded, a parade of people Muchnick impacted took the podium to celebrate his career.
And it was a real thrill to be a part of this. I'm genuinely happy that I'm here because you're such a good guy.
There is no other promoter in the country that could have put together a card that he did like tonight other than Sam Muchnick.
And I know with these words and your energy and your guidance,
that St. Louis will still remain the capital of the wrestling world.
Sam, I know you've been a super promoter, and I just want to say this. May the best things that ever happened to me in this life be the worst things that happened to you and your family. Thank you very much, folks.
The final word of the night went to the man responsible for making decades of wrestling memories, Mr. Sam Muchnick.
I'll be around giving what advice that I can give to the new owners. I accumulated quite a bit of knowledge in professional wrestling in the 49 years that I've actually been in it, 36 years of my own. And again, only thing I can say, thanks from the bottom of my heart.
Sam Muchnick will always be remembered as the heart and soul of professional wrestling in St. Louis. In a squared, circled world filled with giants, he was undoubtedly, pound for pound, the most influential man to ever step inside a local wrestling ring. I'm Mike Colombo. Thank you for watching.